How are you feeling about your new car, the Range Rover that's kept down?
Well, I am actually not much of a car person, to be honest. To be fair to Ekta, she told me which car do you want, and I actually was in London at that time, and I had a couple of friends who were just overhearing the conversation, and they said that, get this car, there's this car, and I just give it to her, and she's like, done, and that's Ekta for you. And then I come and I see this beast, and I'm like, what? So I actually have been going through the 1 month trying to find out on the roads of Dubai when I'm going for my recce and stuff like that. Is this the car I'm getting? No. Is this the car I'm getting? Because I had no idea what was happening. Then suddenly you see this grey, black Range Rover Sport that comes out and you drive it. It feels like something else. I mean, I remember telling Ekta this, that the first time we met was quite funny. I was in a car and she was jogging on the road a branch fell on her. And she thought I'd thrown it at her, but she saw me and she said, Mohit. And I had a film that was very close to my heart, but I hadn't done really well, called Avarapan. And I thought she would be apologetic to see me because the film had not opened that well. And she in fact looked at me and said, Mohit, I've been looking to talk to you. I really liked your film Avarapan. Let's do some work together. And I thought she was just being nice to a flop director back then. But the fact is, at that time, I didn't have my own car. I was in Kunal Deshmukh, my friend's car, and this was Ekta, many years later today, gives me something like this.
What goes around comes around.
Yeah, I guess so.
But the moral of the story is that you make a 100 crore film with Ekta Kapoor,
yeah,
you definitely get a car. You will get a car. Yeah, of your choice, that too. So this is a director special. You are the third director on the show. First was Sanjay Ayan Mukherjee and Sanjay Gupta. And I really like chatting with directors. I've not asked this question. Let me begin by asking you, what's the difference between a good director and a great director?
You know, I think anyone who wants to tell a story in however way is a director. I mean, I don't see a difference between good or great. I believe genius is an idea. It's not a person.
Okay.
I've never seen a film and felt intimidated with a particular director saying, how did he make this film? What I feel is, how did he think of this? That is something that I feel is all, and the difference between good and great is always what they are telling. I think what is a great director, if you look abroad or you look anywhere else, I think is how they think of certain things out of the box, even in a very big film, how they get certain detailing correct, and that's always the ideation. So I always believe genius is the story you tell or the film that you make, and not the person in particular.
So, any directors in your teenagers that you looked up?
You know, I used to bunk college and go to watch Nagesh Kukunur's films. I thought he was talking. Yeah, I loved the film, and I loved Rockford too. And it was a new wave, I felt. You know, I think cinema was changing. I mean, a few years later, Farhan came out with the film that was, but it was changing slowly. I mean, you had the whole multiplex coming in and people.
Yeah.
And that was my formative years of filmmaking, I think. I mean, obviously, you grow up to the great films of Mr. Chopra and Rishida and Bhatt Saab. I think they were great films. I mean, they used to move you. I remember bawling my eyes out when I was really young in Bhatt Saab's films. And they said, how did you understand this? And I was like, no, it's just, you just understand it. It's really upsetting. Yeah. Like watching a film like Daddy, watching a film like Zakam.
Yeah, yeah.
There was something else. So I guess, but you know, in those years when you're in college and all those years when you're actually developing in a personality. But I would say those were the years when I think India was changing in a really strong way. You know, when I started assisting, there were no assistant directors less than the age of 30, 35. Invariably, there were some people who had dropped out from some other field and some other field and had decided now you join films because you have nowhere else to go. It was a place where normally dropouts came in, and I was here, someone who's studying in college and passing out and a science student and doing a business management course and suddenly coming in shorts onto the set. They were like, what are you wearing on the set? Because people really dressed up and came for shooting back then. So I would say, like, I remember me and Siddharth Malhotra were having this conversation that dude, you're young, but you've been around since an assistant. So I've been there since I was 16, as on the set. So I guess, I mean, I can only talk about Nagesh because I remember bunking college for doing that. But There were a lot of directors, I think. I really like Mr. Ram Gopal Verma's films too at one time.
Yeah, I think we all talk about really Ram Gopal Verma's
films. I think he's a genius, that person. I mean, as his ideas were. And he was bold and he was different at that time. You obviously had Karan, you had Farhan, who took the bar to another level.
Yeah.
You had Suraji, who had made something else altogether at that time. Maybe I couldn't identify to at that time, but a lot of people did. And he went against the trend. So these are just films that grew up while you were growing up. You sat and you watched, and you formed your own kind of films then.
So when you made your first movie, it was Zeher, right?
Yeah.
2005, if I'm not mistaken.
Five.
And when you were talking about all these filmmakers who've inspired you to make movies, and those, you know, genius ideas that hit you, and of course, Punging College for Mr. Nagesh Kokunur. Hear that, Nagesh. When you made Zeher, was that the movie you really wanted to debut with? Or
no.
You had to make it because, okay, I think you had the backing of Bhatt Saab, you know, you...
No, it actually was the other way around. I was what, 21 years old at that time? 24 years old at that time. And a year before, that's when it released. I started working on it in 2003 end, and I actually gave out... I was writing a film, and I didn't plan to become a director, because you didn't become directors at that age, you know, when you were, and not at that time. So I wrote it just for the sake of writing a film, and but Mr. Bhatt was the one who said, if you've done this, you should direct this film. And I said, no, you don't make films at this age. And they practically pushed me into making the film. At that time, I didn't think of things like who's the star cast, what should be the thing. Right. Whoever did the film, I was happy with that. I mean, it's not that I would choose otherwise, but I remember at one of the promotion events, someone came and asked me, what if the film doesn't do well? And I just thought to myself, and I said, I never gave myself that option. Mm. You know, what's the best part about your beginning is you don't think about those kind of market trends, and you don't think, no one is talking to you, no one knows you, so no one's giving you an opinion. So when you become successful, they come and they tell you how you should make your films. But if you ask me, my film that I really wanted to talk about, I mean, maybe because they're 21 and they would want an inspired idea is more safer to be. But Kaliyug was the film that I really wanted to start off, and that was something that, you know, I made it in the same year. They both released in 2005. That released in December, and this released. So I had two newcomer hit films with a new cast.
The first time
and both successful in the same year. So that was, and I was all of 24 years of age.
I think you started getting, very few directors started getting critical acclaim early on in your careers. You got critical acclaim for Kaliyug.
Bolame too.
Bolame.
Yeah.
Avarapan also somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, I realized, but then, Bolame was my first flop, and I remember while watching it in the trials, you had a lot of corporates coming and watching the film, and they were bawling in the trials, and I was 26 years of age at that time, and they were like, how did you think like that? And journalists asking me that, and I was like, I don't know, it just looked normal to me. And you know, when I went Bolame, I knew when I was starting it that these are the kind of films I wanted for my own brand. I wanted to make these kind of films, but I didn't think they would. It wasn't a Kaliyug, I knew that. But I didn't. But when I saw the audience reacting to it, I felt that maybe this, I'm wrong. Maybe this is the kind of films that people want to watch. The fact is, great reviews, great thing. I went for promotion to Nagpur, all of 26 years of age, two hits back behind me. And another newcomer cast again. And I go into a theater and I see 9 people in the theater, and that was and that's how a flop smelled for the first time, an empty theater with great reviews, you actually see that the people who had called you for the promotional event, when they called you, they were treating you differently, and when they saw the 9 people in the theater, they were telling you how to make films.
Okay.
You know what you did wrong in the cinema,
yeah.
And that's amazing. I remember during that, I went to a very senior, senior journalist at the end critic, was Rajiv at that time, and I remember me and Vishesh Bhatt walked into his office, and we told him that I wanted to come and watch the trial of this film. Rip it apart if you think it's bad, but if it's good, support it. And I don't know whether it was the confidence or what it was at that time, but that's the film that he still rates as my best film, because I went there and he came for the trial and he's like, this is something else. But there was a mad, at that time I had not seen a flop, so maybe I could see all those kind of, I had that mad streak in me at that time. But when you got those critical acclaim, I'm not saying it wasn't good enough, but it was not converting into anything else. I saw the difference between a film that had done better on the box office, another director, being treated differently from a guy who's just become very popular among his friends, and the 4 stars that he got in the paper. There was a difference in the way the guy who had earned more money was treated.
Right.
in a business circle or in a even in a popular. The fact is, a popular film is more people have seen it. Even True. On the road, they recognize that person more than they did to me. So I understood that very clearly, that this critical thing, it does work as long as it translates into a business model.
You also mentioned somewhere, or am I just making this up, just let me know. Udita has a very important role to play in your life, besides of course being a wife, your good luck charm or whatever you call it. She's come and suddenly it's a whole new wave of hits that you've started giving in. Well, I mean, it normally happens, right? That's what you would...
Well, I tell her that, you know, you've just taken away all the credit that my assistant directors, my cameraman, my actors have put into, and all of them have put into my film. And they're all like, oh, you've got married now, see how your wife is doing. But, no, she was... I've always surprisingly been doing really well whenever. In the middle, when she was not in my life and we were fighting all the time, I was not doing so well. I think it's comes down from your own mental makeup at that time. You're not scattered, you're into one thing. And she gives me a lot of strength in, like, she lets me be the person I want to be. You know, and I remember when you're not married, she was telling someone in my family, it's very easy to be a friend of mine and stuff like that, but handing Mohit Suri for 7 days a week and 365 days of the year is not the easiest job to do.
Right.
And I give her a lot of credit for that. Directors, I believe, are very self-centered when it comes down to their work. They put everything into it. There's no life other than that. You're always only thinking about your film.
Yeah.
Even the books that I pick up, even if I want to go watch a movie, unless there's something connecting to my film, I'm not going and seeing it. So it's about, you know, re-consuming yourself again and again. And that's the best part about her. She's seen me since the day I came in a rickshaw to her house to now the Range Rover Sport. So I guess she keeps telling me that, you know, she came to the set of Villain recently and she saw me on the video assistant. She said, you know, you should not even try doing anything else. Don't even try doing anything. So I said, why? She said, no, you've become worse over the years. I mean, she worked with me the first film and she said, you were obsessive, but now you've become worse. Like, I mean, I actually look into the monitor and I'm almost emoting the shot at the same time. And it's almost like I would go inside the monitor if I had a chance. And she's like, it's become worse. So they make fun of me. In fact, all my assistants imitate me on the set. And I don't remember doing that also.
Yeah.
But it seems I'm just subconsciously doing it. So I guess, but yeah, I think what she gives, she first of all is my boss. She handles everything I do. I don't know how to do anything else. I don't know how to make money. I don't know how to buy things. Yesterday night, we were having an argument about how I can't go for the building AGM meeting. Because I said, I don't know what to say there.
Yeah.
Everyone's going to shout at me and she's like, what's wrong with you? You're like bossing around your set all the time. What are you going to do in a building? And I just am awkward in every space. Whether it's a film party, whether it's anything else. The only thing I know I'm very comfortable on is my set. I don't know people's names. I don't remember them. But the only people, I remember every person's name on my set. And that's the family I really enjoy.
So that's why they call them the better half, right?
Yeah. I think that's cheap. I would say... makes me better.
True that.
Mm-hmm.
And now, I mean, you know, there's this thing where, oh my God, no, you can't, you know, you're a director, you can't fall in love with an actress, you know, nothing, there's no future for you, man. Are you crazy? Dude, you have to marry someone outside this industry, no one will get you. And suddenly you have so many examples in the industry, but, I mean, the fresh is yours because you just got married last year.
Yeah. What do I say? My sister's an actress.
Yeah.
My cousin's sister's an actress. My Pooja's an actress, also a cousin. My grandmother was an actress, who's Imran's grandma. I have actresses everywhere around me. My wife's an actress. How can I judge them?
Is it difficult to fall in love with your co-actor?
Or
is it easy for it? I mean,
well, I fall in love with all my actors, male, female, everything. All right, they become family, become everything.
Well, let me ask you a particular question. What is the moment when you decided that, okay, she will be with me for the rest of my life?
You know, I keep telling her this. When I saw her riding a bike and the way she looks, and she was this whole, looked like this exotic model kind of chick, and she was riding a bullet in Goa when I saw her.
When was this?
During the shoot.
Okay.
Of this thing. She asked for a car from the production. The production said, no, the cars are busy. She says, well, I'll have a bike then. And then she gets her on a bullet and she drives off. I was like, this is the kind of chick I want. So I keep saying I got into a joyride, hoping to think I was getting into like a fun zone. And I found Pati Parveshwar, as I would say. She's and I guess what when I realized is that it's not about the fact that she was didn't want to work with me and all. I don't blame. I'm not saying that was the only reason. But what I realized is in a relationship is not about. I think mostly what happens in an actor and a director relationship is the agendas are different. I think each of them want to have their part of the, and it's not of the sky. And there's nothing wrong in that. And I think that's where the conflict happens because invariably one person peaks before the other person.
Right.
I mean, Udita was getting as much in a show, three times as much in a show than I used to get for a whole film. She bought her house without any loan in one world tour that she did during the Jhalak Dikla Ja phase, and right. I was still living off rent. But she never judged me any differently. Even today, she doesn't take me. She used to treat me the same way at that time that she treats me now. So I guess that was something I think I realized was not going to change with time. She's been with me for 10 years now, before we got married. We grew up together.
Have you ever gone grocery shopping?
A lot, every time. All the time.
Yeah,
I love doing that. Udita loves going to supermarkets and getting the free thing on the product.
Oh, that's such a good trait.
It's amazing. I keep telling her, we don't need the product you're buying, but you're just buying it for the free thing that you're getting on the side. But we love doing that. She loves going to the supermarket. And that's our way of de-stressing. It's really cheap, good shopping.
It's good,
I like this kind of shopping better.
It's good. You know this motorbike thing that you said when Udita was, you saw her and you were like completely amazed. Mm-hmm. Was that the inspiration for Shraddha driving the bike?
Completely.
Thought so.
You know, when I went to narrate villain to Shraddha, it was a different draft. It was still an idea. And I said, you know, it's this girl. And obviously she was a person who's terminally ill and all. Mm-hmm. But before I started narrating, Shraddha was like, what are you doing? You love me, right? So I said, yeah. She said, then why are you narrating? I'm doing the film. Now that really gets you into a very tough spot because the responsibility is now on you.
Yeah.
And that's how smart that chick is, right? So Shraddha does this to me and I was like, now I need to make her special. I need to make her, and I just sourced down the most convenient bank that you have in your life, which is, why did I fall in, what was it about Udita that I fell in love with?
Yeah.
And was it the bike? No, but there was something else. There was more depth on the waiver chick than I thought.
Yeah.
There was more coming home to the person that I saw on the bike. So I guess that was the inspiration that I decided that she should get onto the bike, and that's where the bullet and not any other one.
With so many movies that you've done with Bhatt Saab over the years, what, seven?
Eight films.
Eight films you've done with Vishesh. Was there ever a point where you landed up in a conflict with your producer?
Every day. We always.
Like a major conflict.
Yeah.
More than arguments. I'm saying, like, no, I mean, this has to be done. I mean, keep your foot down.
All the time. But I think that's the kind of test that Mr. Bhatt puts on to you, because how, like, I remember the first shoot, we were shooting for Zeher, and he came to the set to wish me luck, and he said, why don't you, what do you think about the scene? Me and Kunal were there, and I had an alternate perspective to it, and he was like, but don't you think it should be done that? And then, I remember Kunal Deshmukh was my assistant at that time, he wasn't even the chief, and he started arguing with me. And it was them against us. It was just me and Kunal, and we were both of it, 22, defending. And he was 21, right? And we're arguing. We go on and finally, Bhatt Saab, being the person that he is, says, no, fine, do it your way and go shoot the scene, this, that, and all. So me and Kunal walked off, and Kunal just turned around to me and he said, I have no idea what we just argued about, but I just want you to make the film you want to make. And I said, I have no idea too. So he says, let's just go one day down, 59 more days to go. It was a 60-day shoot. And that's how we took each day. But that's Bhatt Saab, I think. I'm telling you, that's, you know, he's very strong about his point of view. But if you can prove him wrong, he's the first one to admit it. And it takes a lot of guts to, I don't think I've reached that state yet, to tell my assistants that, you know, that no, you're right, I'm wrong. It's amazing how he can do that. And he keeps saying that, I've not competing with you guys. That's why you understand I am not a functional director. If I was a competing director, maybe I wouldn't. But I have nothing to get from you all. So that's why I'm fighting, I can see an overview, yeah, which you guys can't see. One day you'll be able to see it. So we do have that info. Like, for example, we have different point of views on a lot of things. I remember when I was even making Aashiqui, there was a day when the production thought I was getting very emotional with that film. I was, my personal life was in a turmoil. I lost my father. I used to cry a lot on the set. I used to work very hard on that set and stuff like that. And I remember once my aunt who handled production called Abhat Saab saying, I think you need to talk to him. He's really moved. And I was shooting the most critical parts of the film. Is when he's, you know, then the relationship is ending. I don't know, that film took a lot out of me. But I remember when he landed up at my place and Adi was sitting with me and Shah was sitting with me. They never let me alone at that phase. And he came in and he said that, I've heard that you're not too emotionally stable at the moment. I said, I'm flawed, but I'm not bad, but sir. And he got up immediately and he was like, called up my aunt, called up everyone saying he's going to make the most brilliant film of his life, I'm telling you that. And I don't know how he had that. He used to use these words like 100 crores and stuff like that time for that film. And we were like, I don't know what he's talking about. These films don't...
Yeah.
I've never gone out to make a film saying I'm going to make a 100 crore film. I've always gone out saying I want to make a good film.
Yeah.
I know what kind of film I'm making. Like, I would be upset if Villain didn't have the shocking opening. I would be upset with that. But I knew what I was doing. Even with Aashiqui, I had put my voice into the film in a way that I didn't know, it didn't fall into your so-called commercial concern. But I said, if this film does well, India has accepted my voice.
The only thing that was going for the movie was the Bhatt Saab's backing, of course, for the Vishesh film. Yeah. And that it already was a successful movie back then.
But it's a 21-year-old, it's a 21-year-old thing. It's a 21-year-old franchise.
Correct.
I mean, to be honest, Shraddha and Aditya had not seen Aashiqui 1.
When they were signed.
Yeah. And I don't think Aditya has still seen it.
Oh my god.
The fact is, see, that was the scary part of Aashiqui.
Yeah, you didn't want them to see the movie.
No, it's not that. I didn't have a problem with that. Aashiqui, the reason I wanted to make it is because I wanted to make that story irrespective. I was dying to tell that story. Mm-hmm. Okay. And it was earlier going to be a senior actor and a young girl. But when I got the opportunity of Aashiqui, the idea of making a franchise of Aashiqui, I jumped at it. I was dying to make a love story after making so many thrillers and everything. But in a company where they had a murder brand and I had just come from that and a Raaz and a Jism, if I was putting another dramatic thing, the worry was they were going to look at the film the same way. So right. When the title Aashiqui came, it just immediately slotted it as a you film.
True.
You know, so that was one marketing genius, I think, it was not about getting, because, you know, technically it didn't open that well. It was a 4-5 crore opening. So it just sustained and went on. It was like, it was viral in the theaters. It went to about...
Had a domino effect.
Yeah, it was like... But it didn't open that big, if you really look at it. Like, my Murder 2 opened much bigger than this film. So Aashiqui, the brand, helped in some traction towards the kind of film it's going to be. But it didn't... If you ask me, did it help in the sale in the opening weekend or not? No, it did not. The music, for example, it was a sword on my head.
Don't even go there, man. Because you were... Was...
Yeah, and you were fighting against the best music and I had very senior filmmakers who were actually known for music saying, you have to use one of the songs. And someone whose music I really trust, but I said, sir, my film doesn't depend on those things. But he said, but that music is too big, what are you doing? I said, sir, but I'm doing... And what I did is, you know, I never tried to outbeat that music. I just said this, that let me make music for today that people like. I'm not saying let's make hit music. I said, if you look at it, it's not fast songs, it's not... And yeah, they're all new people. Yeah, it's just sourcing. I just spent my time and heard one song.
You have a ear for melody, man. I mean, I remember Mustafa Zaid's Awarapan. I think, let me tell you this, I have to admit today, Awarapan is one of my favorite movies.
Yeah, I like it too.
I really like it because I think, I don't know, I mean, I've seen Imran in all Vishesh movies, but for, you know, that film with, I mean, I think something else.
I think that was his last failure film. After which he got Jannat and all that stuff and all.
Yeah.
Somewhere the audience connected with him. The effect of Awarapan came on to the other films. They started taking him seriously as an actor after that. And I always believed in it. I still believe in it and I always did. When I used to talk about how he's got this different style and it's just about peaking at the right time. And I'm glad that happened, you know, that people started recognizing that. His non-disinterested attitude has actually become his style, which is great. And that was him. But people keep saying, you know, when Aarpan didn't do well, you made a great film at that time, and they said that if Imran wasn't in it, it would have done so well. I, you know, I had big actors calling me over saying the same thing, because they had all heard it's a really good film and they really liked it. But I believe that the film would never be made this way if Imran wasn't in it. The depth he put into it, the dedication he gave it. I mean, he actually went into a grave and almost killed himself in the pink covered by mud. I don't know how many big people would actually do that. He gave it his heart, and that's irreplaceable, you know, in a film. You can't say that if you, by changing one thing in a film, even if by changing changing a particular light gaffer also, if you change it, the film's never going to be the same energy.
I think Aarpan was also one of your first movies that that had hit music also.
No, Zair.
I mean, it had. I'm just saying, but I think it was a new. I've had the Mustafa Zayed
I've had
was
the curse of the pressure of hit music for my first film. Like, it's really tiring. I'm telling you, you keep saying I have a great year, but I think I work very hard on it. Like, it's people nice, think I'm almost mad. My first film was Bola Meo Vaate Ve Aatif Aslam was introduced. So that was path breaking at that time. Great. That changed the music. I remember it was a great man like Himesh who turned around and said that music changed because I modeled my music based on that. I realized where people were going into a particular genre.
Oh.
This was coming to stay. And then that whole wave of Pakistan and Himesh music became the new big thing. And he said it. He said, I took that one song and I realized this is going to be the future. Then I had Kal Yug, which had Jiya Dhadak Dhadak and Adat.
Yeah,
then I had Kya Mujhe Pyar Hai and in
Bola Mein.
Then I had Awarapan with all the music. So I guess that all Raaz 2 with Sonio, Mahi. The consistent thing is that they're all new people.
Yeah,
I consistently find these people because I just think they give me that amount of effort that I think, or think my madness would take my shit. As in they come in the middle of the night, they sit and work with me in the music. There's this joke in the office that you call Mohit for a party, there's a very slim chance he'll come. You tell him there's a struggling music director with a great tune and he'll drive all across Bombay and he'll come for the song. So I guess that's just, I enjoy that part.
What's your music? I mean, besides of course the filmy that you hear, but what's those CDs that you have in your car? Besides the Bollywood music?
You know, a lot, yeah. It's just what I catch and I hear. I'm a huge Coldplay fan and I'm all the time into it. Maybe it shows in my thing. But I think I grow with the kind of music I hear every time. And actually, I always source the music that I'm looking for somehow. I just think that some people put a lot more effort into their music. I'm not talking about the studio-ish kind of music and the producer kind of music. But I mean, I've been through all phases. I was a huge Biggie fan and Puff Daddy fan back home in college, then it moved on to other things. And I keep innovating and changing with times or whatever. But what I essentially have stuck over the years has been a certain amount of soft rock, which is something that stays with me. I think that's, I keep gravitating back to that. I think I for me, songs that don't have lyrics is not a song. People say no, but it's this whole EDM space where music is music and that's why it's a song. I said no, so for me, music is different from a song. A song should have lyrics in it.
But I want to stress on the fact, I was just discussing this with a few colleagues of mine, that why aren't music directors working with voices also, like Shubha Mudgal or Lucky Ali, more. You know what I'm saying? I mean, these are also people who have very distinct voices. And I think, I don't think voice grows old.
Voice never grows old. But I think what has happened is India as a nation has gotten to this whole use, consume and junk. There's no savoring of the past. Very few people now want to hold on to records and all. They consume and junk. So I guess what's happening is it's the want for a new voice every season. I know it's amazing that they already want something new in the next season. It's how fast things are changing. Like I remember when Zeher had come out, for 6 months people even knew about me till Kal Yug came. But sooner or later, even with big hit films, you're not remembered three months down the line because the film doesn't last in the theatre for that long anymore.
True.
Similarly with sounds and voices. I mean, today's voice is already outdated in a year's time. Many music directors today don't program the song completely. they wait till the film is going to release and then they change the programming last minute because they feel that the sound today is going to be come out in 10 other more songs. I mean, you have so much more audiovisual than you have radio everywhere. It's grown over the years. So it's not like you're lingering for that voice to hear. You have the access to YouTube, your phone. I mean, no one waits today. I mean, if you go to a place and you don't find the a CD or this thing. I mean, CDs are dead today. I mean, look at it that way. Yeah. So I guess there's the consume, use, abuse, more and junk.
Yeah. I mean, like Arjun is the best example. I mean, he was launched with your movie.
Yeah.
And today it's like,
but you know,
everyone wants him
everywhere. He's everywhere.
And the typecast has even started in music. Yeah. I mean, like, come on. I think the only time when I thought, what is that Arjit was Main Tera Hero when he sang
Yeah.
Title
Track. Yeah.
Like, dude, that Arjit is sound amazing, no?
But that's David, so he's saying it's a hit voice and you should use it.
Yeah. And he used it how, man?
Yeah. But Arjit is a very talented guy. Actually, Arjit, when we used to, I interacted with him first when he was working with Pritam. And he can do everything.
You work with Pritam, yeah, correct.
So he can do everything. He can program, he can write, he can compose, everything. He's actually a great mind. He's a great creative mind. And I think more than a talented voice, he's someone who's a great mind. He's someone who's developed himself. Now he understands, he listens to the brief on the story and he does the song according to that. And because he's got this background, so his assisting Pritam has given him this edge over people.
I think, you know, I had something interesting to say to my colleague yesterday. I said, Arjit's voice, no, it acts, you know, because it gives that pain.
Yeah.
You know, it gives those, you know, he has these subtle nuances in his voice that you feel that aggression. Like how Vishal Dadlani has.
He sits on it. He sits on that and he discusses that. Vishal Dadlani has the advantage of being the music composer.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, I always feel that when a music composer sings a song, no one sings it better than him. Maybe they might not have the best voice, but the expression that a music composer puts into his song is because it's come from his heart. I've rarely seen a singer match up to it. So for Vishal, it's easier to sing his own song. But for Arjit to understand that and take the song to another level is a genius ability to do because he listens. Like there's a song I have to do for Hamari Adhoori Kahani, which is the title track, and the kind of film it is that, I mean, expression is everything in this film. It's not a film that relies on anything grand. It relies on the emotion of the scene and it's the catharsis of the film where the best love stories are never the complete ones is what the theme of the film is, and someone has to mean that. So you have to put in put in that expression of a relationship that you had with someone which was beautiful but never really caught it, found its end and is left abrupt. You have to put that into it, and he was right now in Calcutta on his show and he said, no, I don't think I can do it like a dub. I think I need to come down and sit with you and sing the song. So that's where he is, and that's what I think helps out.
You know, any bad thing that's happened in your life, in real life, that you've actually tried to use it in a movie, which you think has turned out to be one of the most magnificent moments in a film?
You know, everything you do is the experiences that you've lived. I mean, even if you say that you've inspired from this film and you're doing this, the fact is my mental makeup has decided that I watched this film. It's how you were brought up and everything you know. So everything, I keep telling everyone in my life, whatever you share with me is not copyrighted, I'm telling you that. Because you don't be surprised if I put this into a movie. So I put everything into it. But to be honest, that one event that changed my life, I think, was the death of my father. I was making thrillers and stuff like that. I had made Murder 2 and made it with a bag of skills. I felt I was peaking in that. And when that film released and it got what it did, I mean, people didn't expect it to do so well. And when it did well, I lost him 15 days before the release. And it was, and you know, a son always has this thing to prove it to his father that he is also a successful person. So when it released, I remember the whole world was enjoying themselves and telling me, Arey, you've made it. But the one person I was trying to pitch it against was not there. So, and he was a single parent, right? So we grew up like friends. So I had not only lost my father, but my best friend, my motivation, everything. And then came Aashiqui, and I had still not, I don't know what drew me towards the film, and I was like, I want to make a love story. But he said, but it's not a traditional happy love story. I said, no, you don't understand, I want to make this film. And you know, I was still lamenting over my father, why couldn't I give it to him? Maybe if I'd earn enough money, I would ask him to stay in, if I'd this success had come earlier, maybe I was going through the guilt, I wouldn't ask him to stay in Bombay and then his health would be better. I was going through all that. But then I met these kids and I realized that they were both looking for their future, both Aditya and Shraddha were looking up to their future, and while I was holding on to the dead and your life was growing. And suddenly I started finding myself taking care of them because they were scared about, they'd seen failure themselves. And then suddenly I started forgetting about my father, and I realized that's what life is. Life teaches you, it goes towards life and not towards dead. And
evolving.
Yeah. It started evolving. And then I realized that what I enjoy most about my films is if I have the ability, what I enjoy more about anything else is if I can touch someone, if I can affect someone's life. If I can, by my movies or by, like I very selfishly tell Aditya and Shraddha that you all have to become successful for me. Yeah? You all have to become stars. I don't care about, there's a vanity in my thing that you all become stars. Because I want to feel that I've been a part of changing someone's life. And that's what I realized, that stage in my life made me realize that what I enjoy most is helping someone to reach their goal in their life. That,
you know,
that keeps
so
me
important.
Going.
I mean, I feel so happy that if someone junior to me will succeed, I mean, I look up to them. I'm like, wow, man, this is amazing. Because in today's day and age, I don't think, you know, it's just like a dog-eat-dog situation.
Yeah.
You know, you want to just stamp people down and climb the ladder of success.
I have done that and I have realized that
you've done that.
I mean, I probably have unconsciously done that with everyone. But what I've realized with that is that it's like a temporary fix. You need another dose of the drug very soon.
Right.
Because you just did it with somebody else and now you're skidding again. So you need to fix yourself again. Mm. But when you do something like this, it lasts for much longer. It just goes on for much longer.
True.
I remember when, you know,
sustained,
when we... This sustains much longer. And this is, that's what I've realized. And it's not about... And it's not a God complex, I'm telling you. I am telling you, it is a vanity. I'm doing this for my selfish reason. It makes me feel good.
Better.
This is a longer lasting drug for me than the doggy dog, competitive, let's outbeat someone, let's do this and all. And that's what I realized. I mean, I keep telling anyone who works with me that if it is not a plus experience, not only financially, but also emotionally, do not work with me. Because if I can't contribute or change anything, like for example, Tushar, when he came to me, he said, I've been doing 100 crore films.
Tushar Hiranandan.
Yeah, uh-huh. I've been doing 100 crore films, but I want to do something that makes me stand out, and that's what villain happens.
Yeah.
You know, he came to, I said, I have no money to give you. And he said, I'm not asking you for money. So he keeps saying that, you know, you changed my way of how I'll make films also. People are looking at him in a particular kind of genre, which is great, like a blockbuster genre of comedy and stuff like that. But he wanted to make something serious and emotional.
And
so
you gave him that.
And then villain works for him. Similarly with Milap, or similarly with Siddharth.
Like again,
with Siddharth,
him, yeah.
Or with Ritesh, with Aditya, with Shraddha. Even with the music directors that I work, the young ones. I'm not trying to play God, but I just want to live this whole phase of I think it just makes me feel better.
That's amazing, dude. I'm getting emotional, you know, and talking to you about this. But this is so important, Mohit. I think you've touched a chord of how movies are made and what really life is. I mean, people make this a very big thing that, you know, movie making is... I mean,
it's not, exactly. I'm telling you that. I mean, I want to put this on record. If I can become a successful director, anyone can. Yeah. This whole myth that directors are specially born people with a different, they're gifted people, they're born differently, they're mad from birth, it's not true. This is the myth that directors create for other people not to become directors. I am telling you this.
That's another commercial aspect.
Yeah. No, that's a survival mechanism. I've had three assistants now who've become directors. And I myself am 32. Vishal Madkar and Karan Dara is now directing a film.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. So I've had three people who've become this thing, but the fact is that I don't believe I'm the most talented person. I don't believe I'm the most intelligent person. I don't believe I have any philosophical intelligence or any emotional intelligence, anyone different, but I have the talent to work very hard.
And that is
the only thing that will get you far. I'm obsessive about my film and I work 24 hours only on that. I stumble, I make mistakes. But I get up and I work harder. That's the only reason I think I've reached here.
Have you fired anyone?
From a job? I fire everyone every day, but they don't leave.
No, not. But have you, like, really, okay, you know what, I think back off, man. I mean, I don't think you can do that.
You know, I've never thrown an actor out of my film or a crew member. I can't live with myself that way. I'd rather go through the thing myself and compensate for that person's limitations rather than me change something like that in my life. I don't know why. I just have this whole moral thing that I can't do it. I feel, I don't know.
You're too attached. I think it's mental. Right?
I don't think I'll be able to live with myself.
Okay.
And then I realized this very long back in my life that the limitation is in you more. It's not in that person. That you work around it. And I've never been able to tell someone or an actor or technician or something that, you know, this is, if I've got them on board, I think we are all limited. Yeah. Mm. I'm not perfect. I have my limitations. They bear with it. So I should bear with them. It's not fair to just say that I am perfect. This is my bat, my ball, and I'm playing cricket only with who I want to play.
You're making a film on one of my favorite tracks from Gangster. Where's that guy James who sang the song?
I don't know. I think he's after Metro, been everywhere around. What I heard is he's been singing the songs all over the world, and he's not actually technically allowed to do that. So I don't think he's coming to India because of that.
Oh my God! But what a song that was.
That was a great song, and that's Pritam and Anurag at their best. Yeah. They're a lethal team. They're an enviable team. If there's anyone who I envy as a musical team, I think it's Anurag and Pritam. They're inspirational and this thing. Me and Anurag have a great relationship that way. But they're an enviable team, and it's a great track. And it was actually Vishesh Bhatt's idea. It's really interesting about this title. When we were talking about the film, and Bhatsab has written it, and it was an incomplete story. There were different.
Bhatsab written the story.
The story, the screenplay, everything. He's written this film. He's written a film after really long,
film was written by him.
My first film?
No.
Shagufta. The story was the first story. But the fact is this is something that he's
done after eons.
Everything. Like he sat on for 1 year. He doesn't really type that well also, but he sat one word at a time and he's done that. And it's amazing. And he actually said this to me when Aashiqui released, he said, "I want to write for you." Because now he feels that the kind of cinema he was doing is
lovely.
Back. And he said, "I want to write this film for you, Mohit. This is my gift to you." He's not even taking one rupee for it.
I can't give you a range, but I can give you this.
Yeah, and it's worth more.
It's worth much more.
And, you know, he said, "I want to give this to you for what you've done in Aashiqui, for how you've touched me in Aashiqui, and what you've, this thing, and you've brought back the kind of films we used to make." Like he sat there physically while I was making Villain. He used to call me in amazingly sad, word by word, and made this film. And when he gave it to me, I was nothing but moved in certain scenes. I was just actually crying, sitting in Costa reading a couple of scenes, and I was crying in the scene. I was like, "How does this man do it?"
Classic.
And I asked him, "How do you?"
He has it in him
still. Yeah. And I was like, "How do you do it?" And he's saying, "It's just by applying yourself." I guess it comes easier to him. I don't know. I have to work very hard to reach there, but he comes much more easier to him. And you know, there's no other reason to make this film for me other than what the script is. It's not a film that it's going to have your so-called drama like a Villain had of action and this, and you know, a hero, a villain, a heroine. It's a love story of broken hearts and of people who find an incomplete story between each other. But it, you know, and there were these, after Aashiqui's release, there was this whole, in Vishesh, there was this whole thing of maybe you should do a Dil Hai Ki Matani part 2, or you should do a this. And
right.
I kept saying, "No, I want to do this." And this is not a film that we're working with the whole money aspect or this or that. We're just going there with our hearts out. It's not going to have those gimmicks like saying six pack abs or do you know what designer costumes.
Right,
and
right.
It doesn't have. It's just the truth that is there, that we are sitting and working on workshops. We're sitting and we're reading. We've got Rajkumar Rao, who's a brilliant actor. We have Vidya, who's I would say is putting in everything I've ever seen in my life. I mean, I've never worked with an actor like this. Like working, it's like she's like an assistant director, an actor, a friend. She's everything. Yeah, it's amazing. You have Imran, who's come back with the depth of saying that this film has to be made in, and how do we get it to happen in the right way? I obviously share that relationship with him because we've done so many films in the past and we were both assistant directors together. So it's for me to have them. No one's talking about it in a way that's saying that what is, how do we market it, and what is the opening, and no one's talking about the
music. Let's just make this.
It's great, yeah. It's, and that's how the assistants are, and I guess we see how it goes, and because, but these kind of films are important to do. I mean, for your own self also, it keeps you not into that race that says that you're just a number.
You know, I had a crush on Pooja Bhatt. Dile ke manta nahi, dude. She was like hot, man. And she, I mean, I've seen all her movies. But is there, you know, and you felt, oh, if I was a director, I would love to direct her. You know, when you come from this whole family, the Bhatt family, ever thought that, you know, oh, okay, I would love to direct Pooja, but I think Pooja's gone in terms of, you know, not the hibernation.
You know,
or, you know, can I direct Alia in the near future?
You know, Pooja is the biggest, I mean, the best actor I've seen on a set. I assisted on a serial called Dhun with Vikram. Yeah. That was my first job. And you had to see with what ease she used to give a shot. It's amazing. It's almost intimidating. So you're right, I've surprisingly not reached that position to do a thing with her, because maybe I was intimidated with her by her sheer talent.
Yeah.
You know? And similarly with Alia. I mean, I think Alia is a star, man. And she was always like this when we were a kid, when we were kids also. So was Pooja. Like, I remember Pooja, we used to go for drives as a kid, and we used to steal a car in a party, in a family party, and drive off. And if there was a traffic jam and we had, you know, if we, people didn't know how to drive, we stopped the car. Pooja just had to get out of the car and the traffic would stop honking. She was always a star. She had that effect even, and Daddy had just released, I remember.
But that she's was pretty Pooja. Outspoken. She's like...
She was, and she was a star that time also. She was... way ahead of her time.
Guys,
I think
what Ranveer Singh has done for the Bang Bang Dare, Pooja Bhatt has done that long back.
Long back. Long back. I mean, it wasn't even a question. It came with ease with her. Alia has all that. But she's just someone who's more film educated, I think. She's very, in the sense, she's very proper. She's very... Alia's born to be a star. remember when I was at my first film had released and I'd done well, and we'd gone to have dinner at JW Marriott, but someone had taken us there to treat us, and Alia was really young, and I remember...
Which was the film?
Zair,
huh?
And I remember there was a candlelight, and I was looking at her face. She was more overweight than this, than she is now, and I thought she was looking really pretty, alright? As a child, she was like some 12 years old. So I removed my phone, and I want to click a photograph of hers. And suddenly she noticed I'm clicking a photograph, and she's like, no, what are you doing? And so I thought I'd done something wrong. So I said, no, I'm just clicking a photograph. Mm. She's okay, wait. And she makes her hair, and she gets her dimple profile out, and she posed for that. That was her, and she was 12 years old. And right. She was so sorted then. So, but with Alia, there's this whole pressure of giving her, I think she's so good. I think I feel responsible to get her a great script. You know, and
I can imagine people jumping. Okay, no, Alia, this one.
Yeah,
okay, and relax, guys.
I have the pressure of giving her a great script, and she keeps fighting with me. And she meets me at a party, and she's like, well, "Stop making films with other people and making them look pretty." But that's Alia.
Yeah. What about Imran, man? I mean, you know, I know he's, you know, there was this period where Imran Hashmi was considered to be the, you know, single screen god, and I think all the films that he's done were rustic. He's never done a film that was too slick in nature because of the personality that he has. He's even the most reserved person I have met. I've met him on the sets of Ungli. And now that his movie's coming, I think it'll be his first biggest ensemble that he's done.
Yeah.
So getting him back for your film and his, God knows, umpteenth amount of movies with Vishesh. Where do you see his career graph going after a decade?
You know, I've never judged Imran in that sense. I mean, when I worked with... I've never worked with Imran Hashmi, the star. If I really worked with Imran, I was working with Imran in Zeher, in Awarapan. Murder 2 was the last film we did together, but it was his first big solo hero hit. Hmm. I've not worked with Imran, the star. So, if you ask me, I've never judged it that way. I mean, I had belief in him when he was just doing films here. I believe in him when he was doing films outside. I believe in him because for me, it's like not believe. For me, it's like not believing in myself, because technically we both started our education in cinema together. I mean, from the summers that we used to sit together when we were young and watch films in the afternoon, or to come into Vishesh Films office together in 1999 and hanging out in a set and going back and watching films, to going through a college experience together. We've done everything together. Like, he practically my mother was like his third mother. So we've had an upbringing and education of cinema in the same way. I mean, as they would say, the profiling is similar. So you can't take away the kind of way we think. I think he's someone who thinks in a very radical way. I think there's always a reinvention every 7 years. I think an actor needs to do, director needs to
do.
You
said it. Yeah.
If I was making the same thrillers, I would have peaked at one point and then it would have stopped. I mean, you can't expect the same results by doing new results with doing the same thing again and again.
Yeah.
So I think he's in a phase of revamping is what I actually feel. And he's someone who has steel in his head, I'm telling you. He's not someone who's into the... See, there's a certain point you can enjoy yourself till your name comes and your photograph comes on a banner. But in the end, you've got to enjoy acting.
True.
So he likes that job. He likes acting. And
that'll make him long.
Most people just want to be here for their fame or their name or to be considered special about themselves. But you should enjoy the job that you do from 9 to 9. And he's someone who enjoys that. I mean, he pretends to have this whole garb like he doesn't care. But trust me, he knows every dialogue. He knows everything that's happening.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard so many stories of
him. But he's one of the... I remember when I was in a slump after Crook. I still remember this. And I didn't know what... when you have a flop, you don't know what to do. You're like confused and stuff like that. It was him who came to me and he said, make this film, Murder to Me, with the idea. And he said, if you don't direct it, I'll direct it. Actually, he did. He said, but you're the right one to direct this film. But if you don't direct it, because this film is a hit film. That's Imran Hashmi.
Yes.
And I think he's someone who can become a director in the future.
That's a good one. A couple of last questions. We all want, Bhatsab's one of my favorite directors. The man thought out of the box, like Yashji used to back then, you know. When he made movies, like Sadak is one of my favorite movies, man. I mean, that character of Sadashiv Ramanurgar can't get away from my head. I think everything, the overall packaging of that whole movie is, in terms of story, I want him back. I'm sure everyone in Vishesh Film wants him back to direct a movie. Yes, he's emotional and he has his own reasoning for not directing it. But I've heard he's also written this book on UG Krishnamurti. You think that can... get converted into a movie?
You know, as I just said about Imran, as I said that he likes that job of acting. Somewhere down the line, Bhatsab has done so much work, he stopped enjoying the job of directing. And that's a really good thing. And what he enjoys more is mentoring a career like mine. Mentoring a career like Vikram's or Vishesh's now or Karan Dara's. He enjoys that more. He enjoys his book. As his thing. I think he's doing much more than he would do. If he was directing, he would be doing one film in 2 years. But this way, he's doing much more, four films in a year. So I think he's in the
best
stage.
But he has it in
stage.
Him, right?
Yeah, hell yeah. I mean, there's some stuff that he can do that no one can do. But what I think he does best to all of us is, it's not the film. He's written this, but I'm talking about in Murder 2 or any other film that we've done in the past. It's not the film that he works on. He works on... There's nothing similar in my film and Vikram's film and Kunal Deshmukh's film. He works on the personality of a person because invariably we are all extensions in our film of who you are. He makes you find your own self.
Okay.
And that's, I mean, it's not the portion where he's talking about the film that I miss about Bhatsab when I'm doing something else. I miss the point where he's talking about everything else. And you ask me, what has it got to do with filmmaking? It's got to do with personality development.
True.
And that's something that you can't purchase. That you only get from sages, you get them from gurus.
Yeah,
that's what they did. They like I call him. He's like in like Rafiki of Lion King. He's like that for me.
You call him that?
Yeah, because he's all over and he's energetic and he's the one who'll hit you with the stick and tell you that the past hurts, but you know how to cope with it. But he'll give you the stick.
Yeah.
So that's the best example I can give for him. So I think that is more that he contributes in a film than, and that's got everything to do with it, rather than. Story, plot, song. You can still find a replacement, but not for the person that he makes you.
So we've spoken everything about Mohit Suri, the man, the director. I think more of Mohit Suri, the person, than as a director. But we haven't spoken about this one woman who's gifted him this car, yeah. That's Ekta Kapoor. We need to talk about Ekta Kapoor on this show. She's a darling.
Yeah.
You worked with Bhatsab, there's another certain energy that Bhatsab has created. Yeah. Ekta comes from a totally new generation. And at that young age when she turns a producer, I don't think you must have met a younger producer than Ekta Kapoor.
She's something else. There's
Tell me the zest of Ekta Kapoor, how she perceives her movies, and how this Half Girlfriend, the only film that probably in the world that's been announced without a book coming out. That takes some guts, man. That really takes some guts.
You know, and it's amazing how it is. She just called me. I read the book, and Chetan.
The rough, you mean?
Yeah. And Chetan, we didn't have someone to produce it as such. And I said.
So Chetan told you to read it?
Yeah, Chetan wanted to. Chetan and me have been trying to work together for a while.
Okay.
He, like Ekta, also believes that I am a director who's not got his due. And he believes, he likes my films a lot. And we met to just, he said, read the book. And I loved it when I read it, and I loved everything about it. But we didn't have someone to produce it for us. And he asked me, what was it? And I called up Ekta saying, Ekta, I want to make this film. She said, Mohit, no thinking about it, your deal, your thing. Just tell me when to come. I said, come now. And this is middle of the night, me, I was at Chetan's house, and she lands up there and she's like, Chetan, I have belief in this boy. And that's true. She had belief in me even before I believed in myself, to be honest. People think she came after Aashiqui. The fact is, she shined me up a crook.
Wow.
Everyone believes that, thinks that. So, you know, she said, your deal, because she knows, I really love her. And I keep, and for Ekta, I'll do anything. Like, I keep telling her, because the way she believed in me, she made me find my own thing. Like, I mean, the whole world was telling me after Murder to do a film with big stars, and she was like, I'm so glad you're doing Aashiqui. I'm so, the whole industry, the so-called business thing was like work. And she's someone who didn't lose that faith in a flop and a hit and a Friday. So she, when she came with Half Girlfriend in the night, she was like, just whatever he says, I'll do it. And she hadn't even read the book then. It was just her blind faith and seeing the passion in both her eyes. True. That she said, I'm backing people with a heart. And then she's read the book. Obviously, she loved it even more. But you know, people are trying to connect her car thing. Car has got to do with villains. That was another thing altogether.
Okay.
That's another thing altogether. That is her thing saying, you, when we started Villain, she had Once Upon a Time, and her, there was a raid with income tax. She was probably having her lowest low.
Yeah.
And I told her, nothing doing. I mean, I'm going to make this film with her, no matter what. You know, after Aashiqui, everyone's like, what are your options? You know, you should do a film now with stars. And I was like, what is wrong with everyone? They keep telling me the same thing again and again. But there's no strategy. In the end, films are supposed to be made. I don't think a villain would do as well if there was another cast.
Yeah.
You know, this thing. So she's someone who backed it with the right passion. And she's someone who goes on doing that. And that's why, I mean, what you guys are reading off or now talking about Half Girlfriend, even before an actor is on board, even before the book is launched, is the passion of these three mad people who, you know, you've heard a story. I used to hear a lot of stories of midnight meetings with big producers and big ideas were made. This is exactly what happened.
Great.
And I've become part of urban legend, is what you would say.
And your first adaptation.
And my first adaptation.
Great. Mohit, thanks for being on the show.
Thank you so much, man.
Thank you, buddy.
Thank you. It's a great show. You actually really structured it well, man.
Oh, thanks. Well, I don't plan it. I think we just went with the flow.
Yeah.
Done. Yeah.